Welcome to Chronversations, a new Chronicle news podcast and the latest addition to the extended CT publishing podcast universe. Each week, we'll sit down with a local newsmaker, a member of our newspaper staff, to talk about what they're doing, why it matters, and what got them here. I'm your host, Eric Schwartz, editor-in-chief for the Chronicle, joined by co-host Franklin Taylor, vice president and heir to the throne at CT Publishing. This evening, we're talking to State Rep. Peter Abbarno about how he's using his political stature to make our lives better, or at least not any worse. This is not News Dump, so you don't have to listen to Aaron Vantile's dumb jokes. Let's start the conversation, Franklin.
Yep, like Eric said, we're here at the Chronicle World Headquarters in beautiful downtown Centralia with Republican State Representative for the 20th District, former city councilman, local attorney, father of two, radio personality, 2019 Chronicle's Person of the Year, best of Lewis County, first ballot Hall of Famer, and diehard Bills fan, Peter Abbarno.
Hey, thank you, Franklin. I appreciate that. That was a great intro. And Eric, I'm looking forward to a time when you don't have to actually read your intro.
Oh, what a burn.
Mine was verbatim.
That was verbatim. But, you know, it is really nice to be back. I miss the radio when Eric and I used to be on the radio on Let's Talk About It. It used to be a lot of fun. And this is great. I'm glad you're starting Chronversations, a more serious
refined
podcast,
if you will.
I like that. I like it. That's refined, although it's not starting off as refined as you probably wanted.
And I will vouch, when we do Let's Talk About It over at KLA, Peter denies any paper or screens in the room. He wants only his thoughts and his hot takes. Is that right?
That's true. When I do my show, I rarely do it with notes. So,
well, we're practicing, Peter. So
we're not as quick on the times as Peter. We don't have a Facebook Live going.
No.
That is true.
That's true. We're going to break the interview into two parts. We're going to do conventional questions first and then unconventional questions. And we'll start with the serious stuff. House Bill 1540 would direct cities subject to stormwater permits to establish a program to identify and prevent illegal discharges from vehicles. This is your bill.
Yep.
Give us the Reader's Digest version of what it is and where it came from and why people should support it.
Well, House Bill 1540 really stems from the Mellon Street park and ride situation the last couple of years. Some of the folks who live locally remember driving by Mellon Street, and there was a ton of RVs and cars parked there. And it was really a tough situation. It was unhealthy and unsafe, not only for the cars and vehicles and occupants who were there, but the community as a whole, because without any facilities there, people were dumping waste, human waste, down stormwater drains and over by the river. And, you know, you could see nitrate levels increase, and it was just unsafe. So House Bill 1540 really stems from that. And what it does is not only allows more local control and flexibility to enforce the really not as much the parking there, but the discharge while parking there, but it also creates the flexibility to allow local governments to create funds to provide low-cost, no-cost pump-outs, as well as to provide I think greater information for folks there for services, whether it be housing services or for where they could park their vehicles. And mostly this is an issue with RVs, those recreational vehicles, where people don't have any other option to dump out. So I think I tried to find the balance between enforcement, protecting our environment, but on the other side, trying to get those folks to the services and locations where they can perform those dump outs.
Yeah, we don't need Uncle Eddie dumping his RV waste down there.
Well, and it's funny, but it's so true. And if you talk to DOT or you talk to State Patrol or even the city, you know, Kim Ashmore and I had been there a number of times, and he, you know, was a witness to that. And it really was not until we sent photos and information to Department of Transportation and to the AG's office saying, wow, it's creating an ecological disaster in our community, and we really can't have this happen. You need to enforce your own rules, and that's where this stemmed from.
Yeah. And you said in announcing it, too, and you used the Mellon Street example, but you gave the number in your press release. 3,000 people are living in their vehicles in Seattle and the surrounding area. And that a recent NPR radio report noted there's a significant increase in spills. So it's a broader issue than just what you've experienced locally, and it's something that affects the state. Do you think that there's going to be broad enough support in the legislature to get this bill through?
You know, it's not gonna get through this year. This year, I released it later than I really wanted to, but I wanted, again, to be able to strike that balance. But this is an issue all up the I-5 corridor, and there's a number of newspaper articles, even from other news sources in the Seattle area. I won't name names because we're here at the Chronicle.
You're welcome to.
All right, the Seattle Times. But they've struggled in Seattle as a city and as a county, how they enforce not only the RV dumping, but just the waste dumping from folks just camping out, because there's got to be a balance there. And hopefully this bill at least starts that conversation. And my view is, I like the bill. I think it strikes a good balance. Is it a perfect bill? No. And then we're going to have the off session to really continue working on it with the stakeholders to make it better.
Yeah. Peter, you were one of five Republicans on the House Environment and Energy Committee to speak out against a bill that would prohibit the use of natural gas in newly built homes and buildings. What's the status of that bill?
Yeah, 1084 is a bill that does exactly what you said, but it does actually so much more. What it does is it's going to increase the cost of power. It really passes down to the consumers. It takes away choice in power. But where I found almost an equal objection was the fact that the bill actually says that we're going to retrain all these trade workers who are going to lose their job. I mean, the bill actually prepares for all these blue-collar workers to lose their jobs, and it was actually offensive.
Prepare them to get another job?
Yeah, maybe work at retail, for instance. I don't know. And so it's not good for choice, it's not good for price, and it's not good for a lot of our workers. It's just the wrong direction. We should be creating more choices, especially choices like these. With what I'm seeing in the Environment and Energy Committee, they're trying to electrify everything and take all your choice away. That is dangerous, especially for our grid. I mean, we can see what happens in California where the rolling brownouts, right? You're going to start seeing that up here. If your grid isn't diverse enough to handle different loads at different times, it's going to be a real problem. And so that is just the wrong direction.
The trade workers one really is weird to me.
Yeah.
Get them ready, because in the bill, it would prepare them to all have to find a different employment.
Yeah, and you also, you're seeing a wedge being driven between what I would consider kind of this extreme green philosophy of environmentalism, which I think goes beyond what I would think is reasonable, especially without enough science and data to prove that it really impacts climate change, because I think there's better ways to do it. So you're seeing a wedge being driven between a lot of the blue-collar workers and that extreme green, but you're also starting to see a wedge being driven between vulnerable communities, marginalized communities, and those on fixed incomes, because this agenda is just going to raise the costs for people trying to get by. And so it's going to get passed down, whether it gets passed down at the grocery store in terms of the costs of energy, so your foods and services increase, or just in your house when you're trying to heat your home, it's going to be more expensive and less reliable. So I think eventually the messaging needs to get out that this kind of extreme green agenda is on its own. It's not helping a lot of our trades workers, and it's not helping those marginalized communities.
Would you put that in the same vein? I don't know the bill number on this one, but I believe at the end of this decade, you wouldn't be able to register a gasoline-powered vehicle. You'd need to have an electric vehicle. Do you put this in that same category?
Yeah, when you're looking at bills 1091, 1099, 1287, there's a number of different bills that are trying to not only electrify the community, take out all gas, right? Low-carbon fuel standards, perfect example, and then create a system where they will map, track, and reduce the vehicle miles traveled. In 2 years ago, vehicle miles traveled was a piece of legislation where they wanted to track your miles and then charge you per mile driven. Now, that was not to replace the gas tax. That was a tax on top of another tax. That was very unpopular. So what they did this year, and when I say they, I mean the majority in the House, is take pieces of that in all these different bills and put it together that if they all pass, vehicle miles traveled will pass. Gotcha. And so bills that you wouldn't even think are a vehicle miles traveled bill, they're really a transportation bill, are being introduced in the Environment and Energy Committee. It's I guess it's a good philosophy for them because they try to sneak it in. But we've been, I think, trying to get the word out that these bills are just not good for our community, especially.
Especially our community.
Yeah.
Moving on, you weighed in a little bit on the Department of Fish and Wildlife's plans to acquire thousands of acres of TransAlta land. I'm interested in what you see as your place as a lawmaker in this discussion. They're still accepting public comment, obviously, right now, but they're into the process. Mm-hmm. So kind of what's your role in all this, and what's your opinion on the process thus far? It sounded like you were a little disappointed in how you were notified of the entire plan.
Well, you know, notification was a huge thing for me. When WDFW and TransAlta approached me, they said, well, we're just in the beginning phases of this. However, they already had a website up, right? So I found that to be a little disingenuous. My role, I mean, any sort of authorization is going to have to go through capital budget, which I'm the assistant ranking on. And so they're going to need some budget authorization. So that's kind of my role. But, you know, even more so, what I was really disappointed in, and I think I think the Chronicle covered that quote of mine, which was that I heard a lot more about recovery of species than I heard about recovery for working families. And that's what we need right now. Not that species aren't important and that we don't have to care for our environment. We do. And everybody loves natural areas. I mean, I have two little kids, so we love going out in that area. But right now, we need jobs. And, you know, if WDFW's plan is to introduce endangered species that maybe aren't from this area, you know, you can't keep them in a fence, right? They're species. And just like flooding, you know, when with catastrophic flooding, there's the actual damage that was caused, and then there's the stigma that there might be damage. I don't know a lot of corporations and businesses that are going to want to move to IPAT knowing that WDFW is introducing endangered species right in my backyard that might come onto my property, and then I'm going to be overregulated because of that. So I think there's a real danger there that's not being considered.
They'd have to survey potentially too, you know, if anyone who came in and wanted to expand at any point. If it's anything like Thurston County's situation, you'd then have people out looking for evidence of whichever one of these species there is, and if they're there, no dice.
Yeah, and I think that is something that needs to really be examined more. I don't think, you know, and I appreciate the county commissioners setting up that lunchtime discussion. You know, Representative Orcutt and I were on that for a short period of time before we had to go to a House floor session. But in that half hour or 45 minutes that I was part of it, I just didn't hear enough about that working family component, one, and the stigma side of what do you do when endangered species get introduced into your community that really aren't from your community, aren't there now, and how that's going to impact all of us. And I think it will really impact property values, and it's going to impact the ability to create economic development.
You're so right on that. I mean, because I love your point. I mean, you're not going to go build a huge fence and keep all these animals in one area. They're wild animals. They're going to want to move around.
Yeah. And I mean, someone joked and said, you know, the frogs are going to hop across the boundary line. They don't know boundary lines. It's so it's so true, though,
that
right?
That was me.
Was it you?
It might have been.
Yeah, frogs and the pond turtles. And again, it's not that I'm insensitive to the environment or the idea of creating more open space land. I think that's great. It's where you create it, how you create it, and taking into account who you impact. And I think in our community, a rural community that's a distressed area, we need to really start thinking about that balance better and getting that economic development moving. And Representative Orcutt did a great job a number of years ago securing over $50 million for that North County access. So where does that play into it? If iPad is no longer there, for instance, do we lose that money? How do we secure that money? How do we keep it in our county? There's a lot of things we need to discuss first. So,
absolutely. On top of that one, what's a bill or a piece that's included in a bill that people that have not heard of or is kind of sneaking by that you're either in favor of or against?
A bill that's...
Yeah, we always, the media, I'm going to represent the entire media, we always hear during session, you know, you guys should be reporting on this. Is there a bill that you're not seeing any coverage on that you think should be getting
well,
more attention?
Well, I would never criticize the Chronicle's reporting. I
think no, the media, we're different than
oh,
the media.
You know those other people?
The other people.
It's, yeah, the media is different than us.
So it, you know, with issues like that, I mean, as a legislator, I mean, you see... I don't know, 800, 900,000 bills, and you can only really keep track of so many. But I think the media has done a good job on certain hot items. Now, 1263, to me, is a bill that needs more attention. That's my bill on rural infrastructure. But I think capital gains tax, for sure, it has received some media coverage, but maybe not enough. The gas tax had a lot of media coverage, and it started to kind of fade away a little bit. Vehicle miles traveled. Because it's a complicated issue, I know Michael Wagger did an op-ed in the Chronicle regarding that. You know, aside from that and maybe a couple others, I haven't seen it, and it might be because it's a complicated issue, and it's so piecemealed in different bills that they're not making that connection. But, you know, serving on civil rights and judiciary, there's a ton of police reform and Second Amendment type bills that I would say need more attention. Now, whether they advance, I don't know, but I think there's an appetite from the other side for them to advance.
And you mentioned law enforcement right there. Yeah. In the realm of law enforcement, what's going on?
Well, I mean, a couple bills. 1202 was one that went through my committee, Civil Rights and Judiciary, that dealt with civil liability for police officers, which I voted against. You know, when a police officer goes out on the job, the idea that someone can sue them...
Personally,
it just doesn't... It's just not copacetic. I mean, the fact is those people go out there, put their lives on the line, and have so many considerations. And the other thing about 1202, although the other side, I think, and I disagree, there's already options. If there's police misconduct, you do have state and federal remedies. There, you know, you can make a 1983 claim in federal court. There's assault. There's other things that you can bring against a police officer. This creates a whole nother layer to policing that I don't think is necessary. So that's one that I would take a look at. And then 1283, which this creates criminal mischief. So it was a bill that would create criminal mischief, a misdemeanor and a felony, if three or more people are walking. They say acting, but there's no definition for acting. So you would just assume three or more people, and one of them is open carry, and another person feels intimidated by that. That person could make a claim or call the police, and the person with open carry can be charged with criminal mischief.
Is that the same or separate than the they were trying to get rid of carrying during demonstrations at the Capitol?
Is that
the same thing?
This is a little different because, for instance, say, you know, I and my wife and my two kids are walking in Olympia and I'm open carry because I can, and somebody across the street or that I pass by gets scared. Not that I'm doing anything, I'm just walking. I can be charged with criminal mischief. It doesn't take any intent on my part.
I was going to ask that, yep.
Yeah, so what it does is it takes the legal mens rea, the mental state, from me, which would be to intend to intimidate, to them just feeling intimidated. Ultimately, that bill was amended, but it just adds, again, another layer and creates this criminal mischief where you don't need it.
How far does that go if someone just says, hey, I feel uncomfortable here?
You could be charged.
That's where it starts.
You could be charged. And through testimony, what we heard was, well, we'll let a court decide. Well, I was going to ask that.
Wow. Doesn't sound like it would hold up. But
it depends on the judge.
Right.
Right. And then you're stuck in court being charged with criminal mischief. And just remember, if you're charged with something like this, a misdemeanor or felony, it still goes on your record that you were charged.
Chronicle might even write about you.
Chronicle might write about you. Yeah. And when you, when you talk about those bills, I mean, do you see that it's going to be kind of hard for people growing up that wanted to be police officers or wanted to be in law enforcement, changing their mind and us having a shortage of people in those professions?
So, yes, absolutely. And I see it in my own house. So my daughter is in fourth grade. She's always wanted to be a police officer. Angie Humphreys is like her hero. She loves Angie.
She's everybody's
hero. She is everybody's hero.
So she always dressed. And you know, it was interesting because the more she watches television, the more she, and I try not, I wish she wouldn't watch it, the more she watches the news, there's this kind of, you know, I don't know, it's a miscolor of what police officers do. And I know there's bad police officers. There's bad lawyers, bad doctors, bad reporters, bad podcasters. Not on this one, the other one we're talking about. But so to blanket throw everyone into that pot, I think is just, it's bad. So I think you're going to find people who are concerned about this personal liability and are going to be concerned just for their safety when you take away the safety for our law enforcement officers. I think that's dangerous. Now, that doesn't mean that we don't need accountability and we don't need training. Of course we do. I mean, you can never stop learning to be a better police officer, a better reporter, a better podcaster. But this is less about empowering them to be better. This is more punishing them before it even happens.
Before it even happens. Just for being a police officer, it's almost punishment.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Well, kind of on that topic, but not really. What's it like to be in the minority in Olympia? I know this is your first session, but I've always thought it must be frustrating to be a Republican Olympia outside of that majority coalition they had for a while there, yeah. Which was really neat. But what's that like for you? And, I mean, does it affect your decisions when you're thinking about putting forward legislation? You're like, I think this is a really good bill, but it's not going to be able to go anywhere, so I'm just going to keep this on my desk.
No, if you have a good idea, or you think you have a good idea and a good piece of legislation, I think you drop it anyway. I think you introduce it and you try to build momentum. But it's very eye-opening to be in the minority because what you try to do is work with the other side to make their legislation better. And sometimes you just can't. Sometimes it just is so outside of your value system that you just want to vote no. But I've had a Democrat legislators approach me in committee and say, hey, I'd like to sit down with you and talk about how we can make this bill better because I want bipartisan support for it. And I love those opportunities to work with them to make their bill and legislation better because you knew you were a no, you could get to yes. And so that means it's, to me, that is a sign that it's good legislation. But, you know, when we're talking about being in the minority, I mean, we've had 35 years of Democrat governors. Right. I mean, the Democrats have been in control besides that short period of time in the Senate for 20 years or more. I mean, it was probably 2000 when the Clyde Ballard was co-speaker in the House. So it's been a long time. So it's difficult to read newspaper articles about the majority sitting here saying how I can't believe we're at this point and equity and this and that, which is great. But you've created this. The problems that we see today weren't created by the Republican Party.
They weren't magically there.
They were never in the majority. They weren't in the majority. They weren't in the executive branch. So I think having the media start to realize that, and you do see it occasionally because you'll see a Democrat legislator be asked that question. Yeah, but you're in the majority. You can pass this if you want to. Nobody's holding this up. I mean, Republicans aren't close. So I think there's the pragmatic kind of substantive side to making legislation better. And then there's a process side where, you know, there are some bills that if they're great ideas get through. 1263 on my rural infrastructure passed community and economic development bipartisan, just passed on Friday capital budget in a bipartisan, I think it was 20-3. And so now moves on again. So if it's good, people will support it. When it's bad, you either make it better or you just have to vote no.
You know, someone asked me the other day, they said, this is Peter's first term, his first time going up there, and, you know, you get the idea of what you're running for during your campaign, you win, and from the start of you first starting to campaign, until your first day as a state legislator and then getting moved to remote. How's your experience been up there?
Well, I mean,
or in down here.
Well, for me at least, I mean, the two things that I said I would introduce, or two issues that I would try to tackle, is rural infrastructure, because you can't build housing without infrastructure. You're not going to create jobs without infrastructure. You're not going to protect our critical aquifer that Centralia is sitting on top of unless you have infrastructure. Our sewers are old, infrastructure is old, and you're seeing these problems all over. And so that's number one. I said I would do that. The other one, and it's funny because I looked at my old Mellon Street park and ride video from last May, and it was a reminder that was another bill. The two things I said I would do is I would introduce legislation to deal with issues that like Mellon Street, and I would introduce legislation that would build infrastructure so we can do the things we want to do in our community. So on that side of it, I don't think anything changed in terms of my mindset. But on terms of a remote session, I mean, that's difficult. Remote sessions are great if you're a passive observer. If you're sitting back in your house or and you want to click on a committee hearing or watch me on the floor, you can do it. It's great. You don't even have to drive to Olympia for it. However, what I'm seeing, if you want to be an active participant and testify and really get into the meat of some of these bills, it's hard. I mean, some of the legislation I even talked about, we had over 1,000 people signed up to speak, and you get through 20 of them maybe?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm telling you, of those 20 was not a good cross-section of our of the community and the people who supported it or didn't support the legislation. So, but they're just...
Are they selected at random as far as who gets to actually speak?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, no. I mean, they can put it in order. Gotcha. So, you know, it depends on the committee chair. A lot of times they'll say, we're going to get two pros and two cons,
gotcha.
Right? But you're normally going to get two pros and two cons from big associations,
right.
Stakeholders. You're not going to hear from Eric Schwartz in Centralia, who really has an interest in this bill because it impacts his life and his family. You're not going to hear from an Eric Schwartz. And that's what's disappointing, where before you can at least get into the meeting room, pull me aside and say, hey, I'm Eric. I'm from Centralia. I really would like to talk to you about this. You don't get that, where that was what I'm hoping for. Right?
Yep.
I love meeting with people, love meeting with constituents when I can, and you're just not seeing that in a remote session.
How do the lobbyists reach you anymore? Or, you know, those associations and things, is your phone just constantly blowing up since they don't have any ability to see you in person there at the Capitol?
Zoom.
Yeah?
Zoom. There are times, last week I had one day where I was being a legislator, wasn't working, right? From like 7 in the morning to about 9 at night, and I had 23 meetings, all in like 15-minute increments. And then
all
I
on
had,
Zoom.
And then I had, you know, committee hearings, and so you fit them in when you can fit them in. And luckily, I have an amazing legislative assistant, Kathy Ward, and she's been amazing scheduling those. And she was Richard DeBolt's legislative assistant, so she knows the drill and knows kind of how to get that scheduled. But she's been great. But the best I can do is meeting after meeting after meeting after meeting. But, you know, just like this podcast, I mean, we're doing it in person. We're looking at each other. We're seeing the different, you know, body language and the tones. And you don't get that over Zoom. And that's
unfortunate. No, you don't. Or that personal connection. Like really meeting someone.
Yeah.
This is my last conventional question, and then you can add anything else you like. And you're not going to do this, but I'm going to ask anyway. Give Governor Jay Inslee a letter grade on his handling of COVID-19. I thought in your town hall you gave very nuanced answers in terms of, like, understanding in the beginning of this, he was making quick decisions and trying to save lives. And I'm just wondering, a year in, how do you think the governor's done?
Oh, well, I know if I give him anything other than an F, people will be mad.
I know.
And I think if I give him an F, absolutely, other people will be mad. So I won't give him, I'll give him a D minus.
I know you need to be diplomatic.
Well, I guess I'll give him a D minus. I mean,
okay.
Personally, I think he failed. You know, early on, especially, and I know you're talking about when I said, you know, early on in the first 30 days, even 45 days, quick decisions, we were gathering information. He had formed the bipartisan business recovery group that Senator Braun was part of. That got disbanded after 5 meetings.
Yeah.
I mean, it just seems like early on he was engaging other people and then decided, you know what I can do? I can just do emergency orders. I don't have to listen to anybody, and just went on his own. And I've heard that from Republicans and Democrats. I mean, there's a lot of Democrats who are complaining about how the phases were done. So I think generally you'll probably, you know, I can't say what the Democrats would give him. But I would say, you know, D minus F. I mean, early on, not bad. As it went on, it just, it was very difficult. And the way his agencies, I mean, people have to realize when you talk about 35 years of Democrat governors, that means 35 years of Democrat agencies. So, you know, LNI, Department of Health, all ESD. Of these agencies, they're all, ESD, all his. Mm-hmm. I mean, all his. I mean, we can't forget that he picks the heads of these agencies, sets their agenda and policies, really, and kind of sends them out. So very disappointed by what has happened, and was even more disappointed when, you know, one of my first votes in the House was one I voted against a remote session because we were all there. Mm-hmm. I mean, we just proved by being there that you could actually do it.
That was kind of odd and surreal to me.
Right? Let's go there and vote on.
I'm going to vote no because one, I don't think
I vote against being here.
But we're here. Yeah, I'm going to vote against myself being here, even though we just figured a way to do it. But that was tough. And then the other one was when the House really ceded its power to the governor, just said, we're going to vote to extend all his executive orders. And I was like, why would you do that? There's a division between the branches of government. Take the government back and create that checks and balances that you need. And they weren't willing to do that. So
in doing that, it's not as if Republicans, for instance, would have increased power in that dynamic. It would just be the legislature, which is, again, Democrats. So it wouldn't be a whole lot of harm.
It wouldn't have been. And that's the point. It wouldn't have been a lot of harm for them to. I mean, it would have been to my constituents because you would be continuing the emergency orders. But. Right. There wasn't a lot of risk for them to regain some power and create some checks and balances. Disappointing. So I guess D minus is a good way to limit the amount of people who are going to
complain. I didn't think I'd get a grade out of you, so I'll take it.
No, I'll give you a grade. D minus. I'll give you a grade.
You okay with moving on to the silly and unconventional questions? Is there anything else of serious note you wanted to make sure to mention to our listener?
I don't know. Was there anything more serious that we wanted to talk about?
That's all I got.
That's all I have.
That's all I have in my detailed
let's
notes.
Let's get into the fun stuff.
I'm just happy Peter I got the mic know Peter. Here. Aaron's not talking.
I know. It's part of the deal.
He doesn't even have a mic.
He gets a producer credit.
He doesn't even have a mic. Yeah, okay, but Peter, with COVID going on and things are opening up, what do the Abbarnos do to go have fun?
I think the Abbarnos do the same thing we've done before. I mean, COVID is tough, but I mean, we still do the same things. I mean, we still volunteer over at Hub City Mission when we can and still try to do things over at Seminary Hill. I think it's even more important, though, to do things outside. But we've always been one of those families that tries to do things together as much as we can. The one thing that my children... got me to do. I do not like board games. I'll just admit it here. I don't have the temperament or the patience to sit at a table and play a board game for like more than maybe 10 minutes.
Let's have a 3-hour game of Monopoly.
Oh, right. They have got me to play Candyland and Pictionary and all. So I've tried to train myself to do more family game nights, but that's really hard for me. That's really quite a struggle.
I bet.
Well, I mean, Franklin, you know me on a personal level, too. And Eric, you do, too. I mean, pretty active. I mean, it's hard for me to sit down.
Well, I was
going to
say, I mean, I feel like any time I see you, I think you spend more time volunteering or helping somebody that needs help than anybody else I know. So it's hard. It's hard to, with hearing about everything you do. It's hard to even imagine you have downtime.
Well, he gets up at 2 in the morning.
He does get up at 2.
This? No, that...
1:30 in the morning.
That, so it's funny.
He doesn't
on
sleep.
The Person of the Year article, it's funny. I think I told Eric that I get up at like 4:30 in the morning, and that turned into like 3:30 in the morning in the article, which I totally appreciate,
no
but my
way.
Wife's like, no, 4:30.
It's 4:30.
I'm going to fact check this.
You better fact check that.
Fact check that for sure.
But no, you know, volunteering, I love volunteering. I think, you know, on a selfish level, it just makes me feel good to giving back. But it the people I've met volunteering, I mean, I didn't grow up in a household that volunteered a lot. I learned to volunteer, and it just, once, it's infectious. Once you do it, you really just plan it in your week or your day, and you're like, this today I'm doing this, today I'm doing that. And it's teaching the kids
Absolutely.
The benefit of volunteering is so important. I mean, I hope they hang on to that and they never let it go.
And it's not like you guys go volunteer on a Saturday. Your whole family volunteered on Christmas, didn't they?
Christmas of, oh, well, I served at the Hub City Mission. Hub City Mission, yep. Christmas Day, yeah, Christmas morning. Yeah, that was, but you know, they called and said, we need someone to volunteer. And I was like, kids are going to be asleep. I know my wife's going to be asleep because it's going to be early in the morning. And I think it was a 3 to 7 shift or a 4 to 7. And it was great. And just giving back. And we were able to hand out presents to all the folks that were there. And that's just a great feeling. And we do at the Hub City Mission. I mean, they do that fresh market, which is great. And we deliver boxes around town to folks who aren't as mobile. Yep. But need good, nutritious meals, and just delivering that. It honestly, it takes 45 minutes to an hour. You deliver around, and it's not a lot out of your day. You know, I think we could all cut a little bit of television, and not podcast, but television.
Not podcast.
No, because you can listen to this podcast at the gym too. So
yeah, absolutely. Most people do.
I stream your little dumpster fire podcast. Another one.
That's a much better name, the dumpster fire, than
the
news
dumpster
dump.
Fire.
I don't know. other than yourself, who's the best host of Let's Talk About It on KALA 8:30 every weekday?
There's
I was adding a plug.
I didn't know there was another host.
Oh, that's a good answer. Good answer. We'll accept it.
I don't recognize any other host but myself.
Good answer.
That is a great answer.
No, I will be now the diplomatic answer. Mm-hmm. Everybody brings a different kind of angle to it. So I do appreciate that. And I think
they're all terrible.
It.
And when are you going to be back?
I talked to KLA about coming back this summer after session's over. Yeah. I don't think I can do a full on 5 days a week. I mean, that's a lot of work, yeah. But, I told them I would come back on a regular basis to do that. I love it. It reminds me of that town hall, that Zoom town hall. I mean, you don't know what people are going to ask you. Things come out of left field. You just don't know.
It's coming from anywhere.
That's fun. I mean, I like that. You know, it's not like being a reporter.
Mm-hmm.
Where somebody will edit it, you've got some time to think about it. I mean, when someone asks you a question on a podcast or the radio, you have to think as fast as you speak.
Because and it's over as soon as you say it, too.
And it's over, yeah. You don't have Eric editing it out saying, I'm not so sure we want to go that direction.
I'm sure about that one.
You want to grab one off this list?
I'll grab one. Incoming presidents often leave behind a letter for their successor. Did former state rep Richard DeBolt leave anything for you? Any words of advice or anything like that?
It was a crumpled up piece of paper written in crayon, and it said, help me. No. You know, Richard's been great. He is a wealth of knowledge on process, especially. You know, how things work in committees, how to, you know, every person, every elected official, every person generally has that love language. And I always like to tease my love language is sewers, right? Infrastructure, you know, waterways, stormwater. I love infrastructure.
Sexy stuff.
So I tease
good
about that.
Stuff.
But every person has that love language. What is important to them? What kind of, you know, angle they have in terms of legislation? And few people I've ever met have a better feel for, you know, what your interests are in reading you than Richard. And he's really good at that. And so he's been really helpful. And he's going to be great at the EDC. I think he's going to do a lot of great things over there.
You'll probably still have a lot of interaction with him in his capacity with that job, right?
I mean, I'm on the EDC board still.
There we go.
So I, yeah.
Shows what I know.
I don't think I get the invites, but I'm still on that and the Centralia College Foundation board, so.
Excellent. This is the last question we have. If wow. not for politics and the law, what job would Peter Abbarno be working in 2021?
I always wanted to be, well, probably a teacher. I like teaching. I think that's
what subject would you teach?
Something really
the law.
Easy. Something
the
easy.
Law.
No, no, something really easy.
Yep.
You know, I'll tell you. I think that's why I like being in the classroom so much.
When Watchdogs, yep.
Watchdogs is a great volunteer organization. Getting in there and working with the kids is something I really really enjoy. So I'm probably a teacher. I see my wife. I mean, she stresses out, but she teaches like 7th and 8th grade math. I mean, I can't think of anything more painful. Square roots and these symbols I've never seen before. And she could knock out formulas like nobody's business. But I would probably try to teach something easy like social studies. Well, and I shouldn't say that because our social studies teacher might
Something interesting, you mean, like social studies?
Like a political science based science or something. Subject.
You'd be great at that.
I'm not going to avoid bringing it up. Your wife, teacher at Centralia Middle School.
Yep.
I think she was responsible for one of the most interesting news items we've had this year, which was the responses from kids when asked what they thought adults should know about them during the pandemic. I got more calls on that than just about anything we've had. So.
Really?
Good calls? Yeah, yeah. People were just like, I mean, in a couple cases, people called and were really concerned for the kids. Just like, that's a really dark perspective to have. Mm-hmm. It's a perspective. It was basically just kind of holding up a mirror and showing what their thoughts are. I just thought it was great.
You know, I didn't know she was doing that until afterwards.
So it was in the paper?
Well, I think she told me like a day or two before, hey, I'm doing this cool thing with the Chronicle and I was like, what cool thing? I'm like, should I know about this first? But I can tell you, honestly, she did cry when reading those. I mean, she made her, and you know, everyone, you know, when you were growing up, Franklin, you're younger than me. When I was growing up, Eric, I mean, you go through tough times, right? You struggle. But these students are witnessing, you know, unprecedented amounts of horrible things on television and on the radio, some really tough, serious discussions in newspapers, but they're also witnessing family and community members struggling with mental health issues, isolation, drug abuse, divorce, all these things. They're going through things that I don't think we had to, and I don't know what that long-term impact's going to be.
Yep.
But I thought that article, after I read it, was a good window, at least an opaque window, into what we should really start looking at that's going to be a long-term impact. So
that's always one thing I thought about, is moving to remote learning. The kids that are at home and their situation might be poor. You know, they might have a real rough time at home. And school might have been their one escape where they could feel like they're really getting away. They can eat some food, and then they're all stuck at home. I mean,
yep. Yeah, no, sometimes school and their friends and their teachers and their counselors is that outlet to reporting things that maybe are unsafe at home. I mean, as an attorney, I go over to court all the time. I mean, and you see these stories of child abuse and domestic violence and these things that may not be reported right now because those students are not talking to their friends. They're not talking to the teachers. Nobody's noticing the subtle evidence of that type of.
Has there been a decrease in those notices in the school districts during remote learning?
I don't know about in the school districts, but I know domestic violence is on the rise, at least the reported domestic violence and divorces and all that's on the rise. The question is, those are people who have a voice and know how to do something with a minor who can't just go to the court and file a domestic violence protection order or something. They don't have that voice, and I think we're going to see a lot more of that come out. And one of my biggest concerns is making sure the state invests in that as we come out of this.
We're seeing it in the court system. Just over the weekend, the Chronicle had a short little brief news item, but it was a 5 or 6 year old child that a teacher noticed had bruises all over him or her. Sure enough, they talked to the kid, and the kid was like, yeah, I've been getting beat up. And so now that we've got an adult charged with child abuse. But, yeah, like you said, it's not like that kid has the ability from home to call his teacher and say, hey, can you notice these bruises on me? Like, right. It's awful. It's kind of heart-wrenching.
But it is heartbreaking. I think it's only going to get worse. And most certainly, I think, making sure that those students and those children have an outlet and a way to hopefully down the road heal. That's going to be really important. And I don't think it's going to be a one-year process. I mean, a lot of these students and these kids are going to be impacted for the rest of their lives. So we need to be cognizant of that and make sure that we're investing in them and solutions for them. So,
well, Peter, I appreciate you lowering your office to this podcast and coming to visit the studios here, the Pete Caster Memorial Studios.
Is that what it's called?
It's where it used to be his office. We also call it the rat hole, so that's another thing. But we appreciate you coming by, and I know you're very, very busy, and we appreciate it, and I think that'll do it for us.
It's always nice tapping into your wealth of knowledge, Peter.
All right. Well, I thank you very much, and I'm glad that I can help kick this Chronversations off.
Yeah, absolutely.
You'll always be known as our first guest.
and possibly our second and third.
And then you could add that. And I'll just be a regular because after this, no one's going to come on, right?
Yeah. Our list was one, and so we'll see what we get for next week.
All right. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.